5, 4, 3. We're back. We're back at the stage in the Heartland Cafe. It's another edition of the Live from the Heartland show. It's Katie Hogan with myself, Michael James. We're talking to David Schweikert, who is in the philosophy department at Loyola University, and he has written a book called After Capitalism, and this is the most updated edition. Actually, you've updated this 5 times.
Well, under different titles, but I do keep, in some sense, writing the book over and over, you know.
Well, everything changes.
Because the world is changing, and there's new evidence, you know, there's new contradictions.
It's a huge and timely topic. How come more people are not talking about it every day the way...
They are talking about what's beyond capitalism.
Yeah,
there's another book out by a guy named Al Perovitz.
Yeah, that's
right there. That's Gar Al Perovitz. And it seems to me that you talked about some economists don't want to use the word socialism. Krugman called it a dirty word, I think. Mm. But all of a sudden, people seem to be using
it. Right, right, right.
Where are you at on it?
Well, I mean, my big project through my entire, you know, academic life has been to confront the question, because I read Marx actually between my period as being a mathematician and being a philosopher was profoundly affected. Marx is right. There's something profoundly wrong about capitalism. But the question was, what's the alternative? Mm-hmm. When Marx is writing, there wasn't any experiments out there. But by the time I'm looking at this in the early 70s, hey, you got the Soviet Union, you got Eastern Europe, that doesn't look so good.
Right.
You know, and like, this is the, and everyone's, that's your alternative. You know, you either have capitalism with all its warts, or you get something like central planning and so on and so forth. And it was like, is there an alternative to that? Okay. And I became persuaded that the economic structure, first it was like, well, maybe it's just because the Soviet Union isn't democratic, their economy is okay. And I became persuaded by reading people like Milton Friedman, Friedrich von Hayek. No, they're on to something. You do need markets. Markets actually have a role to play in a socialist society. So I began developing, along with a lot of other thinkers at the time, the possibility of a democratic economy that would incorporate markets, but only certain kinds of markets. So I say, when we talk about markets, there's really 3 kinds of markets. You know, we say free market society. There's the markets for goods and services, but they're the labor markets, they're the capital markets. And it's the labor market and capital markets that need to be democratized, okay? The problem isn't just competition. The problem is labor, the problem is capital. And so the idea was, what would you replace the enterprise by? And we notice there's something peculiar in a democratic society that when you go to work, you don't have democratic rights anymore. You've got an authoritarian structure. Why not have enterprises as communities? When you join an enterprise, you get to vote, okay? You know, one person, one vote. You elect a worker council. The council appoints management, at least a certain size. And the argument would be, well, you know, this doesn't work. The problem is, and that's what I've been researching, you know, years and years.
It hasn't been tried.
No, it has been tried at a certain level. And they do work.
Yeah.
There have been zillions of studies of successful worker-run enterprises. So they do work. And in many ways, they work better than capitalist enterprises. So that's the labor part. Capital part. Investment. You know, the investment that people make in the economy, wealthy people, because wealthy people have the money to make investments, are going to determine everybody's life. What regions get invested in, what technologies get invested in, why don't we have any control over that? So my argument is, let's have a society where you have democratic workplaces and you have what I call social control of investment. Instead of having these elaborate, complicated, impenetrable private financial institutions, why not have a simple way of raising investment funds? First of all, don't count on private, wealthy individuals, investors. Notice how every time you turn on the investors, you know, are upset with, you know, so-and-so's policies, the markets are reacting in such and such a way. What is this? You know, why don't we have a nice, transparent, simple system? We need funds for investment. Let's generate it by taxation. Buy a capital assets tax. Let's put a nice flat rate tax on all the capital assets in the and generate that funds. All of those funds are earmarked to go back into the economy for economic development. How do they go back? Let's send them back fairly. So let's say every region of the country gets, as a matter of right, each and every year, its per capita share of the investment funds. People in the communities within states get their per capita share. You can make decisions about priorities.
There's harps playing in the distance. We're living under the biggest tax cut that the wealthiest have ever experienced. How are we going to get folks
the transition
say,
for now, the transformation?
At the same time, how are we also going to stop demonizing? There are people out there, the members of the 1%, who are actually doing good work. Investing after exactly what you're talking about. Resilience efforts, permaculture, sustainability sorts of things, which we haven't even talked about yet.
Right.
I think that is part of the new economy,
absolutely.
So how do we get from, I mean, we just had the State of the Union address. What'd you think?
Well, again, you can see we don't have any solutions for the problems, okay? Because these are really deep structural problems. The problem is we've dug ourselves, and the whole capitalist world has dug itself into a hole.
Yes.
By, instead of keeping production up, keeping wages up, we've decided instead of raising wages, how about loaning people money instead? You know,
and
that
lowering
way.
Lowering standards, seemingly. Lowering standards every step of the way.
Well, I mean, we've got a real problem, you know, and the technologies that are displacing more and more people, putting them out of work. We need to get our hands on a rational system, okay? Mm-hmm. You can make steps. Now, see, my argument is if you have a sense of what an alternative would be that would work. And I argue if you have democratic workplaces, social control of investment, government as employer of last resort, you could have a full employment economy that would be stable, sustainable, doesn't have to keep growing to remain healthy.
Do you ever get in a room with more than 10 people who are working on this?
Yeah, there are a lot of people out there. There's a lot of people doing things. Now, that's the other interesting thing going on right now. There's a lot of people doing things under the radar, okay? Now it's above the radar with Occupy Chicago, but there's, I mean, I
read that book by Paul Hawken.
I was just going to say, I quote him in there. Title. I love the title.
I love the title.
Right. Blessed Unrest.
Blessed
how the
Unrest.
The largest social movement in human history has come into being, and no one saw it coming.
I love that book.
I think that's right.
Everybody out there, you should go get it. Paul Hawken, Blessed Unrest. Right. It's just so hopeful.
And he's not a socialist.
No.
Let's talk about socialism. Is economic democracy socialism?
Yeah. It's a form of socialism. Okay. I'm unapologetic about that, you know.
Because I first heard the term in an article Tom Hayden had written, and then Dave McReynolds, who was a freedom writer and
which
a socialist.
Term? Economic
democracy. Yeah. When he was on the show years ago, I used the term economic democracy, and he turned to me and he said, well, economic democracy is not socialism, but you say it would be.
Well, it would be. And part of that, there was a big debate on the left, and it maybe is still there, but it's kind of disappeared pretty much, you know, whether markets are compatible with socialism, you know, and I've long argued that they are, you know, on the grounds I've just laid out. You got to distinguish among your markets, you know. If you have democratic workplaces and don't have those financial markets out there, having enterprises, democratic enterprises competing, that's okay. That only not is okay, it's desirable because when you reach a certain level of complexity in an economy, which all modern economies are, you just can't plan everything. It is not possible to do that in any of effective, efficient way. And so fortunately, we've got this mechanism out here of competition. It's not perfect. There's need to be regulations and so on. But yes, socialism. You know, if you've got people controlling their work, investment, you've got a socialist society.
I tell you, we're going to run out of time, and you have to promise to come back on this show.
Four more minutes.
But here's a lot of times I'll talk to groups of students or people who approach, and they say, well, what can we do? What can we do?
Right.
And, you know, it's always a little bit of a challenge.
Right.
And I think you address that a little bit in your book. So in the closing moments, why don't you share some ideas on what people who have become aware of the crisis of the economy, the crisis in capitalism, the injustices that abound, what to do about that?
Yeah, no, that is a question. And that's actually something I added to the revised edition because I didn't take that up in 2002 because it didn't seem as urgent. But, I mean, it's basically a three-step project. I mean, first of all, you got to think about getting your own life in order. I mean, you've got, in some sense, your life, you need to live it so that it prefigures the kind of world you want to live in.
Live like you want the world to be.
And you also need to get involved in something. Not, you know, there's lots of different organizations, groups struggling with everything. No one can do everything, but everybody ought to be doing something.
Yes.
And something concrete, something that you can feel like, even if the large project doesn't work out, you're doing something meaningful for real people.
And do you agree, David, that can include belonging to the Rogers Park Garden Club?
Absolutely.
And greening the neighborhood,
helping
start the after-school patrol volunteer.
What I think is really going to be interesting, and I think it's in the cards, you know, and what is really powerful, if you get a sense that you are part of a large movement, you're doing your part. And when all of these groups begin to realize, and I think they're almost all, in some sense, on the same page.
Yes, I think that's true.
And you get a sense that we're part of a movement. And ultimately, we need, if we're going to really make the transformations we've got to make, we're going to need a political movement. So you're also going to have to be talking about, ultimately, a political party or taking over the Democratic Party or doing something. But you need a large movement, but you also need to be doing something concrete on the ground. We've got a project. And to be part of that project, this is one of the things that gave the communist movement in the 30s its power. That sense all over the world there were people trying to bring about something that was going to transform the world. And I think we're in that situation
in the late 60s a little bit when the women's movement civil rights movement.
But it got trounced.
Anti-war. Yeah, it did. But
it got trounced.
Hopefully the next time around it won't get trounced.
Well, and they made
parting words.
Sorry.
We're running out of time.
Parting words. I think we're at a turning point in history. We're not going to go back to where we were. The future is going to be different from what it is now. It's either going to be a lot worse or it's going to be a lot better. And it's possible that it could be a lot better. We need to have that sense and that hope.
So read the book After Capitalism by David Schweikert.
And there will be more copies here in the Heartland General Store.
And also,
I'm sure you can find it online.
And get involved.
Yes.
Do something.
And David, you'll come back.
Oh, I'll be happy to come back.
Okay, let's have a big round of applause for David Schweikert. Yeah. You are listening to the Live from the Heartland show, brought to you every Saturday morning over WLUW 88.7, Chicago Sound Alliance. And we're going to take a musical break. Our buddy Eli is downtown. You'll pick a tune, and we'll be
we're
back.
We're coming back with...